I'm Selmateacher7, also known as Mr. Barry, by my students, and today is day number 9 for the A-plus curriculum, also known as the Network Control Operator class. Today we're going to be going over video cards. Well, let's get started with the lesson.
The technology of video cards seems to be forever moving forward. It is always changing, growing faster, cheaper, and cooler. A video card, video adapter, graphics accelerator card, display adapter, or graphics card is an expansion card whose function is to generate and output images to a display or monitor. Many video cards offer added functions such as accelerated rendering of 3D scenes and 2D graphics, video capture, TV tuner adapter, MPEG-2, MPEG-4 decoding, FireWire, LightPen, TV output, or the ability to connect multiple monitors. Other modern high-performance video cards are used for more graphically demanding purposes, such as PC games or creating videos. Video hardware can be integrated right on the motherboard or the CPU. In this configuration, it is sometimes referred to as the video controller or graphics controller. Intel's Core i3, i5, and i7 CPUs now include a basic video controller right there on the CPU core, further reducing costs for business machines. AMD CPUs also have a built-in video chip. And here we see some examples. Here we see a Core i5 processor with the CPU and the GPU. Here's another example. We can see both of them working there. This is an example of a older video card that had the ISA connection here. This is again another older video card with a PCI connection. And here is a newer video card with a PCI Express connection. And this is what we'd be using today. Let's now go on to outputs. Here's a 9-pin Vivo for S video, DVI for high definition TV or monitor, and a DE15 for the VGA output. The most common connection systems between the video card and the computer display are HDMI. That's number one right now. Today we can also find some monitors which have the following connection types: DVI and VGA. Here are the 8 main types for just DVI. DVI, remember, is short for Digital Visual Interface. So we have DVI-i, single link, DVI-i, dual link, DVI-d, single link, DVI-d, dual link, and the DVI-a, or analog. Here's more examples of those. And over here we have the VESA DMS59 connector that can be found on some desktops that were sold a few years ago. The DVI is a newer standard that was not found on many monitors just 10 years ago. As of today, this interface is found on some Apple and a few desktop computers. Laptops also can have a DVI port, but they are called mini display port and will look like this. You notice it's very small compared to the normal size DVI. The VGA is next. VGA is a video connection that has been around since 1987. The Video Graphics Array, or VGA, connector is one video connection that has had a very long service life. It is a rather basic with a 3-row 15-pin DE15 connector. The 15-pin VGA connector was provided on many video cards, computer monitors, laptop computers, projectors, and high-definition television sets sold from 1987 to 2015, being surpassed only by HDMI. On laptop computers or other small devices, a small VGA port was sometimes used in place of the full-size VGA connector. And here we see a full-size VGA connector. This VGA's proper name, DB15HD, but some have called it the D-sub-15 incorrectly as the DB15 and often as the HD-15 as in high density to distinguish it from the older and less flexible DE9 connector used on old VGA cards, which has the same E shell size but only 2 rows of pins. The video connector is an E size D sub connector with 15 pins and 3 rows, which is a high density connector version. The VGA interface was not engineered to be hot pluggable or hot swappable, meaning that the user cannot connect or disconnect the output device while the device is on and running. The truth is, however, that it can be done, and usually does, not normally cause damage to any of the hardware. Also, depending on the hardware and software, monitor detection is somewhat unreliable when hot plugging a VGA connection. Although many devices still include VGA connectors in 2017, the VGA generally coexisted with the DVI standard. VGA and DVI are both being rapidly phased out in favor of the newer and more compact HDMI and DisplayPort interface connectors. HDMI, or High Definition Multimedia Interface. Here we see the standard HDMI port, which had a width of 14 millimeters, height of 4.5 millimeters. We found this on TVs and computers. Here we have the mini HDMI port, which has a width of 10.5 millimeters, height of 2.5 millimeters, used on some PCs and cameras. Next is the micro HDMI port. The width is 6 millimeters and the height is only 2.3 millimeters. Basically, you only find these on mobile devices such as tablets and maybe some small PCs. HDMI is now the standard port found on all new Chromebooks, laptops, desktop HD TVs, and monitors. When I looked up video cards at Newegg, I discovered that all of the new cards had HDMI as an option, as we see here. Next topic, modern motherboard interfaces. These allow us a spot to plug in a video card right onto the motherboard. AGP, first used in 1997, it is a dedicated to graphics bus. It is a 32-bit bus clocked at 66 megahertz. PCI Express, abbreviated as PCI-e. It is a point-to-point interface released back in 2004. By 2006, it provided double the data transfer rate as did the older AGP slots. Motherboards that can use multiple NVIDIA video cards are called SLI-capable, and motherboards that can use more than one AMD card are called CrossFire-capable. Cooling devices for video cards. Video cards may use a lot of electricity, which is converted into heat. If this heat isn't dissipated, the video card could overheat and be damaged. Cooling devices are incorporated to transfer the heat elsewhere. Three types of cooling devices are commonly used on video cards. Heatsink. A heatsink is a passive cooling device. It conducts heat away from the graphics card's core or memory by using a heat conductive metal, most commonly aluminum or copper. Sometimes in combination with heat pipes, it uses air, most common, or in extreme cooling situations, even water, we'll look at the water block here, to remove the heat from the card. When air is used, a fan is often used to increase cooling effectiveness. Next is computer fan, an example of an active cooling part. It is usually used with a heatsink. Due to the moving parts, a fan requires maintenance and possible replacement. The fan speed or actual fan can be changed for a more efficient or quieter cooling. Water block. A water block is a heatsink suited to use water instead of air. It is mounted on the graphics processor and has a hollow inside. Water is then pumped through the water block, transferring the heat into the water, which is then usually cooled in a radiator. This is the most effective cooling solution without extreme modification. Our next topic is power demand. Newer chips from NVIDIA are becoming increasingly more powerful yet use less electrical power. So a 450 watts power supply is all that is needed for a single video card setup today. When choosing a power supply, be aware that cards made by AMD need more powerful power supplies. Power supplies have several power connectors to supply extra power to video cards that need it, and they would look like this. We're now going to look at different video cards for different needs. The first one here are basic NVIDIA-based cards, which are great for business and multimedia. Here's one by Gigabyte, that's the maker. And this one is EVGA. The model would be the GeForce GT 1050. And it's compatible with DirectX 12. This is software which is used to render 3D scenes. And how much memory? They have 2 gigs of memory. And they're both the same price at $110. And these were prices from February 2017 at Newegg.com. Next is the basic entry-level gaming cards. Here's one from EVGA and one from Gigabyte. Price has gone up a little bit, we see. Now it's $190. Here from the EVGA, we see it's a GeForce GTX 1060. And this is also a 1060. These have 3 gigs of RAM. And again, they're made for DirectX 12. If you notice, these are the 1050s and these are the 1060s. So 10th generation, that's what we're looking at here. That's where the 10 comes from. And the 50, that is a performance rating. So this one is a higher performance. Our next will be mid-range gaming cards. Here we see one from MSI, and another one from EVGA. Now the price has really gone up there, close to $400 for either one of these. And let's look at their name here. They're called the GeForce GTX 1070. So again, the 10th generation, but now the performance rating is up to 70. And it is DirectX 12. Notice too that it has 8 gigs of memory on each of these. Now let's go into the upper mid-range gaming cards. First off is the MSI GeForce GTX 1080. So again, it's going up there in performance. And this one has 8 gigs RAM, $600. This one's over $600 from EVGA. Now we're going to the upper high range gaming cards. We see two here, one from EVGA and one from MSI. And look how the prices have really gone up. With this performance, we're seeing the GeForce GTX 1080. But these are special. These are the Founders Edition. And so they're a little bit higher clock, a little bit faster, and the price reflects the higher performance. We're now going to talk about NVIDIA cards. So here we see pre-GeForce, they won't really fit in here. Then we have the top ones here are the older ones, GeForce 256, GeForce 2, 3, 4, FX, 6, 7, 8, 9. And then we go into the 100, 200, 300, 400, 500, 600, 700, 900. The current one is the 1000. So we have the GeForce 1000 series as the newest ones out. Within each series are more divisions based upon performance. So if we look at the 900s, we see the 900. 910, 920, 930 is the lower performance. Average performance would be the 940, 950. Higher performance, like gamers, would be the 960, 970, 980, and the 990. We'll now look at high-end video cards according to their benchmark or how they perform. The top one right now is the GeForce GTX 1080. It scores 12,000 at CPUBenchmark.net. And there's that price of close to $660. Below that is the GeForce GTX 980 Ti. Then the 1070. And here's a Titan. The Titan is not used for commercial PCs normally, and you can see the price is $3,000. Here's the GeForce GTX 980, it's down there. Keep on going down. There's the 970. Let's keep on going there, down. We find the 780. Here's the 470. 770, and slower ones down here. So the price, some of these are still pretty high, like the 960. So if you go in, you can see the performance has gone down by half. Up here it's 12,000, and down here it's below 6,000. And remember, the GeForce Titans from NVIDIA are well known for their performance capabilities, but they cost around 10 to 20 times more than the average consumer products. Next topic, who makes the graphic processors? There are more than just the NVIDIA out there. For example, we have AMD, ATI, as well as the NVIDIA. So we have some examples from each of these. Here is an AMD card, the AMD Radeon 8350 for $34 at Newegg. Here's an ATI, and this is the Radeon 4650, 1 gig, for $78. And here's a low-cost NVIDIA card, the GeForce 8400, for $30. NVIDIA cards seem to be the best sellers at Newegg.com. Well, that's our lesson on video cards. Please give a thumbs up, subscribe to my channel if you haven't done so already, and big thank you for all the audience who's been out there watching on YouTube. Have a wonderful day. Bye-bye.